Job chapter 1, please. Job chapter 1. And let's pray. Father, we thank you for session number 1 as a means of setting us up to better understand session number 2. And now we turn to study this great servant of yours and the testing, some of the testing that he went through, and the confirmation of the fact that you do work all things together for the good of those who love you, who are the called according to your purpose. So we ask that you'd help us to be attentive, and we ask that you would convey the truth of this message to those in this room and to the ones who listen by recording. And we ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. Job chapter 1, and I'll pick it up again from verse 1, and we'll move on. Job 1, verse 1. There was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job, and that man was blameless, or literally mature, or complete, upright, fearing God, that is, having reverence, respect, reverence and respect for God, and honoring God, and turning away from evil. 7 sons and 3 daughters were born to him. His possessions also were 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, 500 female donkeys, and very many servants. And that man was the greatest of all the men of the east. His sons used to go and hold a feast in the house of each one on his day, which was each birthday, and they would send and invite their 3 sisters to eat and drink with them. It came about, when the days of feasting had completed their cycle, that Job would send and consecrate them, rising up early in the morning and offering burnt offerings according to the number of them all. For Job said, "Perhaps my sons have sinned and cursed God in their hearts." Thus Job did continually. Now, we're going to see Satan providentially allowed to cause some misery in Job's life. But I'd like to mention, after reading those 5 verses, something that Gene Cunningham brought out that I had not really considered, and that is Satan's keen sense of timing as to just when to attack Job, and by extension, when to attack any believer. But in the circumstances of Job, Satan attacked Job at the very time that Job seemed to be in anxiety that one of his sons may have sinned and cursed God in his heart, or the other family members had done so as they were partying. In other words, the concern of a parent for the concern of a parent for his children. And he interceded on their behalf, and at that particular time it was through offerings, and this doesn't seem to be under the Mosaic system. So again, I believe this was probably during the, somewhere around the time of the patriarchs, but he was obviously concerned about his children at the time, and this to Satan apparently seemed like the opportune time to make the attack. Satan kept a file on Job like he keeps a file on all of us, knowing our fears, knowing our buttons to push, knowing the kind of anxieties we have. And Job's greatest fear during this time was probably that his children would somehow reject God in the process of their partying. And so in verse 6, now there was a day when the sons of God, and the sons of God is an expression that is used four times in the Old Testament. It's used in Genesis 6, it's used here in Job 1:6, in Job 2, verse 1, and in Job 38, verse 7. And the context in every verse shows us that this was a reference to angels. So this was simply an idiom of speech representing angels. Now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came among them. The Lord said to Satan, "From where do you come?" Then Satan answered the Lord and said, "From roaming about on the earth and walking around on it." Why was Satan coming from roaming about on the earth and walking around on it? Because that is the place over which he was given dominion before his fall in Isaiah 14. And that is the place where his appeal trial is ongoing. And as he roams about on the earth, what does he do? He seeks whom he may devour. And we find that in 1 Peter chapter 5. And you can turn there with me quickly, if you will. 1 Peter chapter 5. Hold your place in Job chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 5. First Peter 5 and verse 8. Be of sober spirit, be on the alert. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. Now there's one of those places that was pointed out by McDonald, in which a figure of speech is clearly used, and they understood it during that time, just like we understand it today. It's quite obvious Satan wasn't prowling around on the earth seeking one to literally swallow, but he was seeking for someone to give a hard time to, someone to put to the test, someone to afflict. That would be like someone today saying, if we get into a political debate, I'll eat you for lunch. And this is the same type of figure of speech. And there these things come up in the Bible, but they're usually quite clear when they do, or they are some of those things that through the study of the way terms were used in a particular culture historically, we can understand certain things in the Bible to be figures of speech. But as the devil prowls around seeking victims, we must take note of the fact that the term adversary in this verse, 1 Peter 5, verse 8, is the Greek word antidikos, A-N-T-I-D-I-K-O-S. And one of the meanings for this term given in the Walter Bauer Gingrich, Arndt and Gingrich lexicon is an opponent in a lawsuit. And that's exactly what Satan is. He is God's opponent in a lawsuit or in a trial. And therefore, we should, since we are in here in 1 Peter 5, we should take a look at 1 Peter 4, starting at verse 12. 1 Peter 4, verse 12. Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal among you, which comes upon you for your testing, as though something strange were happening to you, but to the degree that you share the sufferings of Christ, keep on rejoicing, so that at the also at the revelation of his glory you may rejoice with exultation. So we understand that he will, and we understand this through his promises, he's going to provide everything that we can possibly need. And he also provides everything in his word that enables us to avoid surprise. So we can avoid being blindsided. And the admonition is given here, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal among you, which comes upon you for your testing. So we need to accept the tip-off in the scriptures, and this is one of the tip-offs, there are many, that there will be suffering in the form of testing. It's not going to be pleasant, but we should not be surprised by it. And with it comes great capacity for blessing and great promotion in the plan of God. And it all has to do with whether or not we remain humble under the testing. In chapter 5, verse 6, therefore humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you at the proper time, casting all your anxiety on him, because he cares for you. So the basis for promotion in the plan of God is humility, including humility under testing. Because we have failed under testing and fallen apart under testing, does that mean we ultimately will fail the testing? No, it does not mean that. If it did, then Job clearly, since Job came through fine during the first two chapters, but then fell apart and remained in chaos through the rest of the book, through most of the rest of the book, But ultimately, he got the message and he passed the test with flying colors. So you're going to fail. You're going to fall apart. You're going to, because you have fallen apart under testing, you're going to go into guilt reaction and shame, and your enemy is going to use that to keep you down, to cause you to give up, so that all things will not be working together for your good and the good of others on your behalf. So expect this. Expect pressure from Satan. And the old saying, when it rains, it falls. Well, that's certainly biblical, because when we see what happened in one day in the life of Job, one thing after another, we see that the pressure was being put on intensely by Satan. And so we have this day in verse 6. Now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came among them. The Lord said to Satan, "From where do you come?" Then Satan answered the Lord and said, "From roaming about on the earth and walking around on it." The Lord said to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job?" A rhetorical question, because certainly Satan had considered the Lord's servant Job. Because God goes on to say, "For there is no one like him on the earth, a blameless and upright man, fearing God and turning away from evil." So God was saying there's no one presently like Job on the earth. Job was the most spiritually advanced believer in that time. And so the Lord asks Satan rhetorically, "Have you considered my servant Job?" Knowing that Satan had considered his servant Job, and Job was a thorn in Satan's side, and Job had kept a file, or Satan had kept a file on Job, looking for every opportunity to afflict Job. And so, verse 9, "Then Satan answered the Lord, 'Does Job fear God for nothing? Have you not made a hedge about him and his house and all that he has on every side? You have blessed the work of his hands, and his possessions have increased in the land.'" So Satan's accusation was, "Job doesn't really love you. You're just a blessing machine," in the mind of Job. And so in verse 10, "But put forth your hand," or I'm sorry, verse 10, "Have you not made a," or verse 11 is where we want to go, I'm sorry, verse 11, "But put forth your hand now and touch all that he has, and he will surely curse you to your face." Now there's one thing that can be read between the lines there quite obviously. In fact, Satan was blurting out something that he really likes to keep a secret. Satan was blurting out that Satan is powerless to interfere with the sphere of protection that God provides every believer, and that he can only afflict believers when he receives divine permission to do so. So in verse 11, but put forth your hand and touch all that he has. He will surely curse you to your face. In other words, Satan wanted to get at Job directly, but it was going to have to be indirectly. He was going to have God's permission to do it. So verse 12, then the Lord said to Satan, behold, all that he has is in your power, only do not put forth your hand on him. So Satan departed from the presence of the Lord. And so again, what comes up, 1 Corinthians 10 and verse 13, the fact that God will not allow any believer who is being tested to be tested beyond the point that which she or he can honorably endure. In other words, continue to fulfill the spiritual life and glorify God in the process. That is the believer who is indeed prepared for bona fide testing. We're not talking about divine discipline here, but testing. And Job was prepared for the testing. The Lord said, there's not one like him on earth. There's no one like him on earth. And of course, Satan knew that. The Lord was just rubbing Satan's nose in it. And in fact, Job was, in biblical history, such a great servant that he is mentioned by Ezekiel as one of three persons throughout all biblical history at that time that characterized spiritual completeness or very advanced spiritual maturity. We read about that in Ezekiel 14. You can turn there with me, Ezekiel chapter 14. And in Ezekiel 14 and starting at verse 12, Ezekiel 14, verse 12. Then the word of the Lord came to me, saying, Son of man, if a country sins against me by committing unfaithfulness, and I stretch out my hand against it, destroy its supply of bread, send famine against it, and cut off from it both man and beast, even though these three men, Noah, Daniel, and Job, were in its midst, that is, at the same time that the country was being disciplined, by their own righteousness they could only deliver themselves, declares the Lord God. In other words, they wouldn't save the nation. Their righteousness, and that this is speaking of imparted righteousness, the righteousness of God working in and through the believer, that must be differentiated from imputed righteousness, the righteousness the believer receives from God at the point of belief on Christ, because that righteousness is accrediting to that person's account of God's eternal righteousness, which always remains. In other words, God always sees that person as he sees his own son. He who knew no sin became sin on our behalf, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. 2 Corinthians 5:21. So, and to the one who does not work but believes on him who justifies the godless, his faith is counted for righteousness. That's imputed righteousness. But often in the Old Testament, especially, the word righteousness is used in a different way. That is imparted righteousness. That is the believer making progress in the spiritual life and the righteousness of God working in and through that believer. And so there are three exemplary characters that are pointed out here. In verse 14, Noah, Daniel, and Job, all from different time periods. And the Lord is saying that the land can become so evil, the nation can become so evil, that even if these believers who were the most advanced believers of the times in which they lived were in the midst of the country at the same time, then their righteousness or their manifestation of God's integrity would only be enough to save themselves, but would not be enough to deliver the nation from its impending disaster. And this was in reference to the disaster of Jerusalem and Judah. And this shows us, number one, the principle of blessing by association unto the preservation of a nation is something that is real. It is biblically validated and documented. It is real, and it is delineated in Leviticus chapter 26, and it also shows us that there comes a time when there is too little and too late positive volition toward God and his word. In other words, there aren't enough believers expressing God's imparted righteousness in the world or in the nation that is about to be destroyed by God. And so in Job chapter 1 again, Job chapter 1, Job chapter 1 and verse 11, put forth your hand now and touch all that he has. He will surely curse you to your face. Verse 12, then the Lord said to Satan, behold, all that he has is in your power. Only do not put forth your hand on him. So Satan departed from the presence of the Lord. So the Lord gave Satan permission to have Adam with restrictions. So the Lord controls the boundaries of the testing. Verse 13, now it happened on the day when his sons and daughters were eating and drinking wine in their oldest brother's house, that a messenger came to Job and said, the oxen were prowling and the donkeys feeding beside them, and the Sabians attacked and took them. They also slew the servants with the edge of the sword, and I alone have escaped to tell you. While he was still speaking, another also came and said, the fire of God fell from heaven and burned up the sheep and the servants and consumed them, and I alone have escaped to tell you. While he was still speaking, another also came forth and said, the Chaldeans formed three bands and made a raid on the camels and took them and slew the servants with the edge of the sword, and I alone have escaped to tell you. While he was still speaking, another came and said, your sons and your daughters were eating and drinking wine in their oldest brother's house, and behold, a great wind came from across the wilderness and struck the four corners of the house, and it fell on the young people, and they died, and I alone have escaped to tell you. So, what would, think about it, what would Job's first reaction have been? Very possibly one of shame and guilt. My children must have cursed God, and I probably didn't pray for them enough. I didn't intercede for them enough. And this is fear, guilt, and shame are the methods that the enemy uses to get under our skin and to turn our progressing spiritual lives around to regressive spiritual lives. Every fear we nurse, every form of guilt that we cling to and revert to, and it's hard not to do it. I was just listening to someone today on radio, and he was very good on this subject, that we guilt is a big problem. And we think we have it resolved, and then we run into the person we haven't seen for quite a while we have expressed guilt over something we did to that person, or in some way we damaged that person, and the whole thing comes back, even if we've gotten it right with God, even if we've made appropriate amends to the person, the guilt easily comes back to haunt us. And that's a tool of Satan. And fear and guilt cause us to doubt the love of God and the integrity of God and the grace of God on our behalf. And one of the enemy's favorite methods of destruction, one of his favorite schemes, is to disrupt a believer's life and to bring on chaos through circumstances that are going to make the believer's life chaotic, and in this cycle of chaos will be fear, shame, and guilt going around and around and around. And so in verse 20, then Job arose and tore his robe and shaved his head and he fell to the ground and worshipped. Tore his robe, shaved his head. Indications of appropriate mourning. His children had just been killed, and nevertheless he fell to the ground and worshipped and said, "Naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked I shall return there." Meaning there's really an ellipsis there, and that is a play on words. Naked I will return to the womb of the earth. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Verse 22, through all this Job did not sin, nor did he blame God. And so this is all quite remarkable, that this servant under this kind of pressure would stand so true, stand so faithfully, would show his reverence to God, his awe of God's integrity, his recognition of God's grace, his recognition that he did not deserve anything good which came to God, and anything good which came from God was from God, and it was by the grace of God. And you could turn with me to Romans chapter 12. All of this testing that Job was undergoing was to display to the enemy and to the other sons of God, that is the angelic realm, both the elect angels and those who rebelled with Lucifer, the fallen angels. It was to exhibit to the angelic realm how this man Job's thought processes operated. The spiritual life is all about how we think. And that's why we are exhorted in Romans 12, verse 1. Romans chapter 12, verse 1. Therefore, I urge you, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies a living and holy sacrifice, acceptable to God, which is your spiritual, or better translation, logical service of worship. And the service was from a word which was a priestly form of service. So it was spiritual service. But it was logical, the most reasonable or logical spiritual service. In other words, not the sacrificial system where you present the bodies of dead animals, but present your bodies a living sacrifice. How? By making your bodies available to the Word of God. Verse 2 explains, and do not be conformed to this age, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, so that you may prove, the word is dokimazo, that means you may prove with a view toward being approved what the will of God is, that which is good and acceptable and perfect. And so what do we do with the Word of God? We allow the Word of God to transform us so that we're not conformed to the status quo of the world, of the cosmic system. And you can, I don't care what cable news station or network news you might watch, they present the world as they see it. And you can watch that. If you watch enough of it, you'll be distracted from what's really going on. And there is, I'm fascinated by the political landscape, but I do recognize there is no one in our nation who is going to be elected to the presidency or to any other office who is really going to make a difference in the way this nation is going. There may be some postponement as to some of the discipline, but we're going the way that the world system is going, that is specified in the Bible. That's why it is so important to have a literal hermeneutic. We understand what's going to happen. We understand the world is not going to get any better. We understand that in Romans 11, the branches that were grafted in after the natural branches were temporarily cut off, the branches that were grafted in are going to be cut off. That's going to occur at the rapture. And the natural branches will be grafted back in and will be at home with the Lord in glory. And that also indicates that if you do not continue to stand with a recognition of His grace, you too, the branches that were grafted in, will be cut off. So the rapture is not going to happen because we've been a great exhibit of God's character on the earth. We're going to be cut off at a time when the church has overwhelmingly failed, with wonderful individual exceptions, which is always the case in every dispensation, but every dispensation of human history ends with failure on the part of the human race. But we're not to be conformed to this world. And while all of these things go on about us in the political spectrum and in the arts and cinema, theater, music, and all this worldly stuff and all the technology of the world and the sciences and so forth, life goes on in the cosmos under the ruler of the cosmos, as it always has. It's just that the evil and the deception have been stepped up, have intensified, as the Bible has said would happen. And so what are we going to do? 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Second set our 2 Corinthians chapter 4, and I'm in 1 Corinthians chapter 4. That's why I couldn't find it. So now I'll turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. And in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, starting at verse 16. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 16. Therefore we do not lose heart. That is, we do not quit. We do not let guilt and fear and shame keep us from functioning in the spiritual life. But though our outer man is decaying, that's our physical body, including our brain, which is the temporary vehicle through which the soul functions, that's decaying. That's why we get dementia if we get old enough, many of us, because the physical body is decaying, but the soul remains intact. And the soul that has received the Word of God as a way of life, though it may not appear to us on the outside, that soul is intact. And that soul will go into its glorified body and express itself perfectly and wonderfully, and will be who we really are. So though the outer man decays on a daily basis, on a minute-by-minute basis, our inner man is being renewed day by day. That's with the assumption we are being renewed by the Word of God day by day, that we are indeed allowing our minds to be renewed or renovated, Romans 12, verse 2, by presenting our bodies a living sacrifice simply by making them available to the word of God. For verse 17, momentary light affliction is producing for us an eternal weight of glory. Think of temporal compared to eternal. We can't logically make the comparison. All we can come to terms with is that there really is no comparison. And that's why Paul says that for momentary light affliction, no matter how long we endure through it, no matter how many years a person has had to remain in a communist prison camp like Richard Wurmbrand, or no matter how great and intense and ongoing the suffering, it's light affliction compared to the eternal weight of glory. It's beyond comparison. For momentary light affliction is producing for us an eternal weight of glory far beyond all comparison. Paul was admitting there's no basis for our being able to compare it. We have no premise by which to compare it. Verse 18, while we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen, for the things which are temporal, for the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. So that's where we keep our focus. It's a slow process, but I am being weaned by the grace of God from overoccupation with what's going on in the world to occupation with Christ, with whom I am risen at the right hand of God, with him where he is seated at the right hand of God, according to Colossians 3, verse 1. If you be risen with Christ, and you are first-class condition, then keep your mind focused on where you are with Him. Set your affection on the things above, not on the things on the earth. For or because you are dead, that is, crucified with Christ, and your life is now hid with Christ in God. I love having a hiding place, and that's exactly what that is. It's a place your mind can go. I love the way that's put, being hid with Christ in God. I love that hiding place. I hide from the heartbreak, from the horror that's going on in the world, from the brutality, from the chaos, from the shame, from the guilt. I hide from these, from the fear. I have a hiding place. And my hiding place is in Christ with God. Let's close with prayer. Father, thank you for everything that you've given us tonight. Thank you that we are a new creation in Christ, 2 Corinthians 5:17. Old things have passed away. Help us to turn our minds from the old things which have passed away, even though they are in some cases current events in time, but they're still old things which have passed away from the eternal viewpoint. Help us, Lord, guide us, we pray, so that in whatever time is remaining, we may serve you to the utmost and fulfill the life, execute successfully the spiritual life which you have graciously given us to fulfill. And we know it's only by your grace that we can do so, and it's only by advancement in the information that you have given us in your word that we will accomplish this. And we know that it is not us who accomplish it, but the grace of God in us. So thank you in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen.
So they don't know what that's about. But there are just things going on that are disturbing, and they need tons of prayer for protection. So I appreciate your prayers.
And let's pray. Let's pray right now as an assembly for that. Father, we thank you for Faisal's testimony and the testimony of his wife, Carrie. And we do ask your protection. We know he understands the danger, and we are so thankful for his courage and his heart for the lost and his desire to serve you. And we pray, Father, for your protection on him so that he can run his course, can fulfill his ministry for you, and so that many may be saved. And we pray that these inquiries may be deflected, and that Faisal, through your protection, might continue to openly preach the gospel and teach others so that they may preach the gospel and teach. We ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen.